Hey buddy, welcome back to the channel. My name is Andy, je suis the uncommentator. This is episode number 7 of this FIFA Street playthrough. Now, if you're new to the series, first of all, you missed out on my special offer, and second of all, you won't know how the series is working. So just a reminder, each city that we visit, we're going to do in two parts. This is going to be part one of the current city that we are now in, which is Lagos. So we're going to do 4 friendly matches, and then we're going to sign a new player. And then in part two, we're going to do 3 friendly matches, sign a new player, and then do the Rule of the Street tournament. So we're going through the... This episode number 7, as I said, we're going through the Rule of the Street mode. So just a reminder what we've done so far. So we've beaten Marseille, New York City, Rio de Janeiro, and now we're visiting our 4th different city and our 4th different continent, this time travelling to Africa. So let's do just that. Now, as I said, we've got four friendlies that we're going to do. First of all, before we get the new player, so go straight into kickabout. Now, the last signing that we made was... It was Xabi Alonso, wasn't it? It was, I think. Yep, it was. Right, so for the opening match here in wonderful Lagos, I think we're going to go with... Does it matter? Let's go for Cafu and... Crespo. But no, let's stick with Alonso. Let's stick with Xabi Alonso. Right, so up against the Outlaws. Our overall is a lot higher, so this should be fairly straightforward. I don't recognise any of the players, so I guess we're going to find out who we're up against. So let's do just that. I will try and score these goals a little bit quicker than I have been doing. Although I'm hoping my theory about cities being easier comes true. So if it does, this particular couple of episodes, these two parts, it won't take as long as some of the other ones have. Certainly the ones in the last city that we did. So Lagos, the 4th city that we've visited. So hopefully, as I said, if the the odd number theory is true, then this shouldn't be too bad. Although if it's going to keep passing to the wrong player again, like it normally does, then this is going to take a while. Oh, the right player that time, and amazingly, there we go. It passes to the player I want it to, and he scores. And by he, it is me. It's Ivan Pelizzoli in goal. Whatever happened to Ivan Pelizzoli? That'd be a good documentary. Former Roma goalkeeper, of course. I think it was Football Manager 2005. Of course, other management games are available. Where he was a young keeper at Roma, and he was amazing. I seem to recall. I think it was that version. I think it was him and the two Roma keepers. Who was the other one? Now I can't remember who it was. It was Pelizzoli and I want to say Abbiati, but he was AC Milan, wasn't he? Say yes, everybody. Pelizzoli, was it now? Pelizzoli, and I think it was an older keeper. No, was it Doni? Or was Doni a little bit before that? I think Doni may have been before that. Sorry, after that. Doni ended up at Liverpool. They didn't put them off signing goalkeepers from Roma, though, did it? So, Brazilian goalkeepers from Roma at that as well. So, yeah. Anyway. So still 1-0. This is taking longer than I wanted it to. It's already nearly 2 minutes in and we're only 1-0 up. I mean, maybe 1-1 in a second. No, we're not, because I have a goalkeeper. Brad Friedel makes the save. Yeah, I always think it's good how... I always think it's crazy how, like, on management games, certain players have really good stats or get really good. It makes you wonder, and then obviously, and then sometimes in real life it doesn't quite work out like that. It makes you wonder where they, I mean, you know, you can't predict the future, obviously, and injuries and just basically players not fulfilling their potential. It makes you wonder, where they get their ideas from, though, for certain players. Like Pelizzoli, like I think, I talked about Guillermo Okoye in the last couple of episodes about his, could have had a better career. And he was a perfect example of a player that was really good on management games. But I think, to be fair with him, I think he did fulfil most of his potential in real life. I think he's... Every time I've watched him play, which is not very often, admittedly, I think he's been really good. So, again, he's one of those players where I think, why have you not had a better career? But anyway, we've gone off topic a little bit from Ivan Pelazzoli as Xabi Alonso, not known for his heading. Well, he did score a header in Euro 2012, was it? I think it was. He scored a diving header against somebody. I may be wrong on that one. So there is some precedent there. Right, don't wait this. I shouldn't waste this game breaker, I don't think. No, as good as Pelazzoli is, no chance for that one. I do quite like this arena. You think the arenas should get better as you go along. They don't always. But I do like this arena. It looks really sort of ramshackled. And I'm sure ramshackle's the word that you don't hear on many YouTube videos. But it's the one I'm going to use. Because I think that's an accurate description. The only way this area would be better is if it wasn't nets that we're shooting into. It was just like an open sort of pathway. That's why I like the... that's why Rome was my favourite arena. Because of the nets. Because the style of the goal. Also, is it just me or do the goals look different sizes? On different areas. Like this goal, I think, looks massive. Compared to the goal in... Was it New York? I think it was New York that didn't look a very big goal. Maybe it's just me. Still have no idea who we're playing against, apart from Pelazzoli, of course. And still the triangle trick doesn't pay off. Great skill there from Alonso, and a finish to match. So 4-0, we've now found our rhythm. So that's good. See how many goalkeepers there are in this country. I think it was it the second one we did, New York, where every team had Vita Bayer in goal. So see if we get a mix of keepers here. Right, we're going to try and keep a clean sheet, if we of course can. Easier said than done, sometimes. Not done a taunt yet, have we, to get the combo up. That was annoying. Right, one more goal, nearly 5 minutes in. Just a reminder, of course, the friendly matches are 1-5. The Rule the Street tournament matches. The quarterfinal and semi-final are 2 3-minute halves. That was a good strike. And the, there we go. And the final is 2 5-minute halves. Alonso again. A bit of a goal machine so far. Xabi Alonso, so I think we'll be sticking with him. It was Cafu that was playing, wasn't it? I thought it was Rivaldo. If I was saying Rivaldo all the way through that, I apologise. I don't know if I was or not, but I kept thinking it was Rivaldo, but it was Cafu, wasn't it? That we actually picked there. Cafu were a little bit shorter than Rivaldo. And of course, we ignore the request to save the game 4 times per episode as well. Which is more in more sometimes than 4. Anyway, right, on to the next match against the Cats. So, we'll see if we win this by a whisker or if we win it comfortably. Right, so the team for this game is going to be... We'll stick with Alonso and we will pick... Let's rotate the squad. Because, in my mind, there's fictional fatigue and morale for these players. So we'll go Crespo and Alonso. So we'll go for the two with shooting specialities. Okay, the opposition looks like Timo Hildebrandt. There's more than one goalkeeper. Look, the guy number 4 looks like Robbie Keane. 22, I have no idea. And 44, DeMarcus Beasley, is it? I guess we're going to find out. Who was that striking? What was he? Is it Eddie Johnson? I think an American striker called Eddie Johnson. I think it was about this time. Maybe it's him. Speaking of wasted potential, it's not Freddy Adu. I know that. Freddy Adu is actually on this game, and he's a playable character. So we won't be playing against him, but I could, in theory, sign him. And in some ways, I want to sign him. That's a good start. Let's hope that continues. Good goal from Alonso. There we go, beating Timo Hildebrandt, another goalkeeper that... actually, what happened to Timo Hildebrandt? He's another one, actually, isn't he? Timo Hildebrandt. What happened to him? His star seemed to fall pretty quick, although based on this performance, I'm not surprised. Even I'm scoring past him. Yeah, he broke through at... I think he was at Stuttgart when... I think he was at Stuttgart when they won the league. When they'd... They did win the league one year, I think. They had Kevin Karanyi up front. I'm not sure if they had Philip Lahm on loan or not. That was dreadful goalkeeping. That was where Philip Lahm kind of made his breakthrough. He had a season on loan at Stuttgart and really kind of kicked on. In fact, I think it was the 04-05 season. Well, here's the potential DeMarcus Beasley. Well, every shot's going in at the minute. 3-1 after 30 seconds, so we're going to find out who it is. It is DeMarcus Beasley. What a good guess that was. Another player that I've had on management games several times, and he was very, very good. Another football manager favourite from 2005 of mine. I remember signing him for Hull. I remember it was Hull City once, and I got promoted to the starting League One Hull City, which is the third tier of English football. I got promoted to the Championship, and I think it was the first season of the Championship or the second, I managed to sign him off PSV Eindhoven, and he was amazing. He got like a 9 out of 10 every game. Because, I mean, I'd signed him a few times in the higher divisions, and he was good then, so I knew second tier of English football, he'd be amazing, and he was. Although he was enlisted as an attacking midfielder left-right, and if you played him on the right, he was absolutely hopeless, but if you played him on the left, he was great. On the right, he'd get 4 out of 10, but on the left, what a great finish that was. He'd get nines every game. That was a bit odd. I'd say Hildebrand, based on this, no wonder he didn't have the career he should have done. Yeah, what did happen to Timo Hildebrand? Did he end up at Bayern Munich? Bayern Munich tend to just buy the Bundesliga's best players. That's why they win it all the time. Any other Bundesliga team gets a decent player, they just end up signing them. Normally on a free transfer as well, which is, I'll say normally, not always, but sometimes. Lewandowski was a free transfer, which is an absolute joke when you think about it. I think Leon Goretzka was as well. I think Manuel Neuer was. I may be wrong on those two, but I don't think I am. So I'm not quite sure how they keep managing to do it, but they do. What was I talking about? What did happen to Timo Hildebrand? Where did he go after Stuttgart? I can't remember. That's today's quiz question. I've been doing quiz questions in previous videos. What happened to Timo Hildebrand? There we go. Unfortunately, I can't give you the answer to that one at the end of the video because I don't know. Come on, Crespo. Let's get this game won. Almost there. Not long to go. Tackled by Alonso. Can Crespo finish from long range? No, he can't. We'll get another game breaker, then get this match over with, potentially. How did he miss that? See, volleys do seem to go in better than just... I must say, when we're through one-on-one with the goalkeeper, it very rarely ends up in the net. But you just do a random snapshot, or like get on the end of a long ball, it tends to go in. Nice skill, DeMarcus, very good. Let's see who this guy is. This is Robbie Keane. I think it was, wasn't it? Yeah, so Hildebrand, where did he go? I can't remember. I don't think he did go to Bayern Munich, but then again, if he didn't, where did he go? I do remember them winning the league. It was under Felix Magath, I think. Get this game breaker in. I may have hit it straight at Hildebrand here. I've tried to put it in the... No, it's gone past him. That's fine. Yeah, the goals of Kevin Karanyi helped them through. Anyway, that's a nice, comfortable victory. We beat the Cats, so we didn't beat them by a whisker. It was a perfect performance because we won 5-0. No, I don't want to save the game. Okay. Oh, we're up against Reading again. Yeah, the same names all the time. Right, do I put my stats up? No, we'll not bother with that. We may do that. We'll do that maybe before we try and make our latest signing. So, friendly number 3. And you know what? I'm going to stick with the team. I think we're going to go Alonso and Crespo, because that worked pretty well last time. So, we'll stick with that. Once again, Hildebrand in goal. We've got Robbie Keane there, I think, again, number 40. 21. Looks like Gabriel Heinzer, but I'm not sure. 20, no idea. With any luck, we won't find out. We know who the goalkeeper is, though. I
These kickabouts can be fun, but remember, skills are respected.
Right, let's go then. You see me rolling and passing to Crespo and then missing. I do find it interesting how most African players, well, I say most, I've got no evidence to back this up, but a lot of African players that kind of make it in Europe, they tend not to get plucked from African teams. I say tend not to, I mean, I could be wrong, but it's very rare that you'll see like an African player. It's rare that they'll leave an African side and then join a big team. It's kind of a gradual thing. So I don't know if, like I remember, like Ahmed Musa, for example, that when he signed for CS, I think he signed for an African team at like CSKA Moscow. And then before obviously moving on to Leicester, but you know, look at people like Samuel Eto'o or Didier Drogba or teams like that, you know, that they tend to join academies. They tend to like join academies at uni rather than like have a couple of seasons at first team football in whatever country that they're from, and then sort of get the move. Like I know he's I don't want to say a late developer, but slightly later developer than some players. Like Riyad Mahrez, for example. I don't think he ever played in Algeria. A lot of it's to do with where they were born and their upbringing. You know, some players, they weren't, you know, even though they've got the word I'm looking for, because we've conceded. Who scored that goal, actually? Because from this story, then, Julius Agahawa. So we are playing against the Nigerian. So he's a good example, actually, of that. Not that I know where he came from before Shakhtar Donetsk, but what happened to Julius Agahawa? He's another one. They didn't have his celebration animated. That's a shame. Did a great celebration. Come on. I'm banging on about African footballers here. Yeah, I think most African, they don't have, what's the word I'm looking for? When you're eligible, not citizenship, but anyway, whatever. We'll just call it eligibility. So, yeah, they may have the eligibility to play for a nation, even though they weren't born there. So I don't know if that's the case for like Mo Salah, for example. I think he was born in Egypt, but again, I think he was another one that moved at a very, very young age. But then, to be fair with him, he had a slightly longer sort of journey to the top because he was at Basel in Switzerland, wasn't he? I'm trying to think of a good example, but I can't really think of one. The only one I can think of is, well, there was Samuel Eto'o, like Kolo Touré, for example. Who, you know, whatever people think of him, has had a great career and is underrated. Ooh, that was unlucky. Did he ever play in like at the Ivory Coast? Or if he did, it was, you know, he was soon out of there, sort of thing. You know, it's rare that you'll get to like 24 and you're playing in an African league of some description and then get a move. If you're any good. I don't know what point I'm trying to make with all this, but it's better than an awkward silence, I suppose, isn't it? Anyway, 2-1, on Hernan. About time we got another goal. Hildebrand's improved since the last game. So it's taking a little bit longer to get through this particular friendly. Yeah, I think the point I'm making is like it's rare you see a player like tear it up in Africa in like, you know, up to the age of, say, 24, and then get a move to Europe. And that's the point I'm making. You know, they tend to move at a much younger age, either move as like a teenager or move as like an academy player. Or, like I said, you get players that just have dual nationality. So, like, I think Mahrez, we're talking about him. I think he was born in France. He just had like Algerian in him from some member of his maternal or paternal family. Obviously, they're not all like that. Oh my days, that'd be unbelievable. There we go. But like, I was looking. The reason I mentioned all this rubbish is because I was looking the other day and at the history of the Nigerian Premier League and the top scorers that have. All the top scorers in Nigerian Premier League history, and I've never heard of any of them except I think maybe two. One was Ahmed Musa, which is why I mentioned him earlier. I think I can't remember his first name. There was a guy. There was a guy that played for Getafe, and his surname was Uche. There was two Uches. There was Kalu Uche. The two Uches that I've heard of. There was Kalu Uche. And then the guy that played for Getafe, whose name first name eludes me, Uche, I think he was the top scorer in the Nigerian league. But yeah, I think a lot of the top African talent gets kind of snapped up, you know, into an academy, basically. Anyway, 5-1. Which actually gives me a quiz question that I can actually give you the answer to. So let's go. So we'll not save the game. So the quiz question of this episode is, which Nigerian, well, prior to this season when it was broken, it was a record broken by, I can't remember his first name, Makoko at Borussia Dortmund. Which African footballer held the record as the youngest player to ever play in the Champions League? Before the Champions League, before the 2020-2021 Champions League season, which African player held the record as being the youngest player to ever play in the competition? So I'll give you the answer to that at the end of the episode, so you can have a think of that one. I may give you a clue, I'm not sure yet. Anyway, we're going to change the team here, so we're going to rest. We're going to bring Cafu back in, and we're going to bring Rivaldo in. So no Christian Vance, which seems a bit harsh, he's never done anything wrong. So we're up against Pelazzoli, Beasley, and two others. Against the Piranhas. Yeah, so which African player held the record before this season, 2020-2021 season, as the youngest ever player to play in the Champions League? I don't know how old he was specifically, but I know it was, in years it was 16. 16 years and so many days. So that's today's question. There may be a clue on its way. I can't decide whether to give you a clue. I'm not going to say the country that he came from. I'm not going to say the year that it was. The only clue I may give you is the team that he played for. Or possibly the position. But he was another one that, to be fair, he was another player that had a decent career. Got to be surely. What are we doing? We just run away from open nets. That's what we're doing. Bit of a kick clash here. You need to be very, very careful when you say kick clash. If you get it wrong, you could really, really be in trouble. Right, there we go. 1-0. Yeah, a little bit of a kick clash here. Obviously, light blue and black. They're obviously either a fan of the flag of Botswana, or they just think my colour schemes are very stylish. I don't know. Or neither of those two things. Well, that was a good effort. So it was a longer halfway line back heel. I do like as well, you get a very small audience. So we've got a few people watching. In this sort of, as I said, ramshackled land. We've turned into a football, don't say pitch, but you know, a football playing area. Yeah, I have to say, I think it's getting tougher to. Oh, that was a good finish. I think it's getting tougher to win because the goalkeepers are getting better. But the fact our players are getting better, so therefore the shooting stats are getting better, should negate that. Although once this friendly's out of the way, we're on to trying to make a new signing. So I'll explain if you're new to the series, I'll explain what we do for that when we get there. I've said this before, but I've said everything before, really. If you've watched the whole series, I keep repeating myself. The main reason I do it is because I don't trust anyone to actually watch the whole series. So if they've just randomly clicked on this video and no idea what's happening, then I appreciate any views. But I think sometimes it's just nice to explain what's going on to people. I'm sure anyone that's watching this video is aware of how FIFA Street works. And he's maybe just reliving a childhood or something, I don't know. I don't know what motivates people to watch my videos, but whatever it is, I appreciate it more than I let on, I can assure you. That was a nice goal. That was very, very nice. Who was it? Looks like Sebastian Coelho. Oh, Alberto Gelardino. What happened to Alberto Gelardino? That's another quiz question for you. World Cup winner, Alberto Gelardino. In fact, that gives me another quiz question, actually, which I'll do after this attack's gone in. There we go, I knew it was going to go in. Okay, so Italy won the World Cup in 2006. Excluding penalty shootouts, which player was the only player in the squad to score more than one goal in the tournament? And he got two goals. So despite winning the World Cup, none of their players, apart from one, scored more than one goal. So who was that player? So we've got the youngest African, the youngest player to play in the Champions League was African. And then we've got 2006 World Cup squad, Italian World Cup winning squad. Who was the only member of the squad to score more than one goal? I'll give you a clue, it's not Gerardino. But he was in the squad and he got one of them. And he was one of the players who got one goal, I think. So that's what reminded me of that. So ignoring penalty shootouts. I think there was only one penalty shootout, wasn't there? Anyway, the one in the final. So ignoring that, who was the only player to score more than one goal? And he got two. And both those answers to those quiz questions will be revealed after the final match. Actually, this hasn't been Brad Friedel's greatest finest hour. Although that was an own goal, apparently. So there's no replay. Own goal from Rivaldo. I think Rivaldo's finally looking like we may need to replace him, but not been his greatest performance. Quite a few of his problems haven't been his best, have they, so far? Or is it Cafu? I keep getting them mixed up. Given the fact one's a lot taller than the other, you'd think I shouldn't, but they look quite similar. Yeah, there we go. I think it's Cafu, actually, that's been poor. He's one of the lighter colour shorts. I think it's actually Cafu that I should be slagging off. Anyway, 5-1 or 5-2, whatever it was. Yep, 5-2. So the piranhas are... I'm trying to think of a fishing pun, but I can't think of one. No, I don't want to save the game, but I do the next time you ask me. Actually, no, I don't. Yeah, I do. Ignore that. Yeah, I do. Of course I do. It's the end of the episode. Anyway, move on. Right, so now we're going to sign a new player. So you've done the four friendly, so progress... You can see their progress there, 4 out of 8. So that's what we do. So we're going to sign a new player now. Let me just check one thing. Rule the street. So we need 2,000 skills build to enter, so that's fine. Right, so we need to now sign a new player. Now, I've said this before, but I'm trying to retain a player. Let's just go back to the squad for a second. I'm trying to retain a player who has each one of the five skills as their best stat. So you can see there we've got two players with good tackling, one player with high speed, one player with shot power, one player with shot accuracy, and one player with tricks. So the obvious player I need to replace here is Lazaridis, but I'm only going to replace Lazaridis if I can find another player with speed as its as their best stat. So I'm going to do that now. So let's see who's available. And of course, another reminder, we only sign the players... Clicked on the wrong button. We only sign the players that are... Oh, there we go. They're all unlocked there. So we only sign the players that say unlocked. So we don't, let's just go back to Lagos for a second so I can really labour the point. So you can see there, Michael Ballack, to unlock Michael Ballack, we'd have to pay 7,200 skills bills and then beat him. Now I'm only going, now as you move through the game, those players that you have to pay for eventually just become available. So I'm only going for the players that are already available. So that just labours that point. So let's see who we can go for. But Mark Viduka is shot power, I didn't think he'd be paced somehow. So we're not going to bother with him. Right, Cisse's still not available. Solari is speed, but he's not very good. Makaleli's tackling. Sorensen's obviously a goalkeeper. Right, Kanu is tricks. Yakubu is shot power, I think. And Helguera is tackling, so again, we ignore all those. So Cafu, Viltord. See, Viltord is shot power, so no. So we'll go forward, check out Amsterdam and Rome. So Amsterdam, we've got, there he is, Freddy Adu, talking about him earlier. I wouldn't mind Freddy Adu, actually. He'd be, not just for a laugh, but actually wouldn't mind him. No idea who Edward is, no idea who Lenny is, not that it matters anyway. Right, Sean Wright-Phillips is pace, so I think we're going to go for him, but let's just see if there's anyone in Rome that's unlocked and his pace. No, they're not, none of them's unlocked, so we don't need to worry about that. So, we'll do what we said. We'll go Sean Wright Phillips. But before we do that, I'm actually going to improve my own stats. Was it 2,000 skills builds, wasn't it, to get into the tournament, to enter the Lagos tournament? So we'll just bolster these a little bit. I want to leave at least 4,000 skills builds left, though. Just in case we lose the... that'll do. Just in case we lose the tournament. If you lose the tournament, you don't get your money back, so you've lost it, so you have to pay to re-enter, basically. So there we go. So we're now 69. No comment on that one. No comments on that one, please. So a 69 skill. Right, where are we going? Amsterdam, isn't it? Because we're going to try and unlock Mr. Sean Wright Phillips. We're going to unlock Bradley's brother. Right, so Cafu was poor in the last game. So I'm going to go with Rivaldo and we'll recall Alonso, I think. Give Rivaldo another chance. Okay, so it looks like we're up against... That 31 looks like Bernardo Corradi, but I can't imagine he's on this game. Obviously, Sean Wright Phillips, I've no idea who the other two are. Let's go. Maybe Paulo Ferreira? That's another good quiz question. What happened to Paulo Ferreira? It's interesting with Sean Wright Phillips, because once he left Man City, he seemed to... his career never seemed to recover from that. He was in and out at Chelsea. That was a poor effort. He was in and out at Chelsea, and then... In some ways, Bradley became a bigger star because Bradley was pretty poor in England. I think he ended up at, was it Southampton or Plymouth? And he wasn't great at either of them. Then he went to New York Red Bulls and became a bit of a MLS sort of icon. Well, I don't say icon, but you know what I mean. He was really good in the MLS. And then obviously, then I think eventually Sean Wright Phillips ended up at the same. I think they both ended up at New York Red Bulls. I don't know if Bradley played for anybody else, but I guess he may have done, given how long he was there. But yeah, it was weird, really. It reached a point where people actually considered Bradley the better player, which you would never have thought in the early part of Sean Wright Phillips' career. I was a little bit surprised how much he struggled at Chelsea. Well, I say I wasn't. He wasn't, I'm not sure if he was an air quotes Mourinho player. But at the time it looked, I mean, it was a lot of money, but I think it was a time when basically if Chelsea came calling for your player, the transfer fee went up 5 million. It was one of those. And in fact, he was English, which also, you know, English club signed an English player. It was always, got a price increase. Sanchez in goal. Is that Osvaldo Sanchez? I have no idea, to be honest with you. One thing I do know, though, is it's 2-0. And my Gold Knight 90s are... they've got magic in them. Magic in my boots and ice in my veins when I'm through on goal. Right. Sorry, Sean. Okay, just run into him. I don't know what I was doing there. That was a bit stupid. A good pace though there from Wright Phillips to get away from me. My pace is pretty decent. He's not as good at tackling as I am though. Do we set Rivaldo up here? Yes we do. And he misses. Can I show him how it's done? Watch me, Rivaldo. You don't. From a Ballon d'Or winner, I'll show you how to finish. I've nearly got a game break here already, which I didn't actually realise we were so close. Ooh, there we go. The hopscotch move actually works. Rivaldo taking 300 years to get his shot away, but he still manages to do it. I thought I was going to get tackled then, which would have really annoyed me. He's hit it at the goalkeeper anyway, so that's pretty irritating. Oh, come on. Well, the goalkeeper would have been on the ground after that game breaker, so has he got back up yet? Yes, he has. Right about that. That game maker not going. I'd have been even more annoyed if he'd not got it away, because I don't know why he took so long to shoot there. There we go. Didn't save that one, did you, Sanchez? You see, that's what I'm saying. Ballon d'Or winner Rivaldo needs me to show him how it's done. But 3-0, we're well on our way here. And you're well on our way to getting the answer to the quiz questions that I've set. So just a reminder of what they are before we reveal the answers. So which member of the 2006 World Cup winning Italy squad was the only player to score more than one goal? And who held the record before Makoko broke it this season as the youngest ever Champions League player? And he is African. And I'll give you a small hint if you haven't got it yet. He's a defender. That's the hint. So it's not Lukaku. It's not Lukaku. Lukaku's Belgian anyway, so I don't know why I said Lukaku. I mean he's got DR Congo nationality, but obviously he represents Belgium. So yeah, just to be clear, it's not someone who's got African heritage, but hasn't, well, I say heritage, you know, African nationality, but doesn't actually represent an African nation. He does represent an African nation, just to be clear on that. I don't know why I said Lukaku then. So it's not, yeah, it's not Drogba. That would have been a better example. It's not Samuel Eto'o. It's not other African player who's not a defender. Come on, me. There we go. Well, Rivaldo, you've been watching me carefully, haven't you, buddy? One goal to go. And then we're good. Can we get it this here? No, we can't. Good save from Sanchez. That was a good trick. Heel boy. Not as good as that one, though. Oh, there we go. What a great goal that was. He's been really good, Alonso. I think he's been our best player. So I think of all the players I've had, he's been the best one. Obviously, he'll never... Nothing will compare with Dulgoldo, or whatever we called him. Golgado. But he's doing a good job. Right, so the quiz question answers were the only player to score two goals in the 2006 World Cup for Italy was Luca Toni. He got two goals in a 3-0 win against Ukraine. Everybody else only got one goal, so Del Piero, Grosso, Totti, Materazzi. I think there must be another who scored, but I can't really think of those. I think Gelardino scored. And then the other question, the youngest Champions League player before Makoko, it was Celestine Babiaro. So that was the African defender in question there. Right then, that is the end of part one for Lagos. So that's the end of episode 7. So yeah, if you enjoyed this video, then please like and share the video. Because we comment the video should you choose to do that. While you're on YouTube, if you head over to the channel, The Uncommentator, then you'll find the rest of the videos in this playlist. You'll also find, well, eventually when they go onto YouTube, you'll also find all the other games that I've currently played through up to this point, so please go and check all those out, that'd be fantastic. But join me next time, we're going to be moving on to part number 2, so episode number 8, we're going to be finishing off Lagos, so we're going to be doing 3 more friendlies, the Rule the Street tournament, and then we're going to unlock another player to add to the squad, but we're not going to do it in that order. But that is all still to come, so join me for that one, but I'll take you to that point. For now, from me, it is sayonara.